Greetings, brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm Casey from Servant's Heart Worship Center in Columbia, Tennessee. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to be notified about new videos and live streams. You can also like us on Facebook or visit our website to stay up to date on news and events. Links to our website and Facebook page are in the description. And now, today's message.
Americans have been conditioned to want and need evaluation, approval. It starts happening when we're little kids. Remember in school when you would have to go and get when the parents would come in, the progress reports, remember those? You'd go to the school and then later on when you got in the workplace, there were employee evaluations. And these are designed to communicate to us areas that we do well at and areas that we need to improve. They're designed to make us better people, smarter people, better employees, but mainly they're designed so they can get the communication out there, so the teachers can communicate to the parents and the parents can take the ball and start working with the kids at home. That's what these are all about. Between the authority to the home to the child, this trickle down is what these are designed to do. Evaluations at work, they reveal our strengths, our weaknesses. They give us a chance to prove things, to make us better employees and stuff like that. And in Scripture, if I have one thing that a lot of people will talk to me about, they'll call the pastor, or I'll get an email from somebody, or talk to an old friend, and it always kind of comes up in conversation. A lot of Christians want to know, they say, you know, I've been serving the Lord, but I just don't know. I don't know if God's hearing me, if he's not hearing me, and I don't know if what I'm doing is where, what I'm supposed to be doing. I don't know if this life that I'm having and living is the path that I'm supposed to be on. Why doesn't God speak to me? And it's always sad to hear that, because God speaks to every one of us through his Holy Spirit. God has always communicated. He's always given us evaluations throughout our lives. We just have to learn to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, and to yield the words and do what the Holy Spirit says to do. Throughout Scripture, God often gave evaluations to people, both individually and on the whole, to his people as a church, for the lack of a better word, the collection of God's people. And he used a variety of people to do it. He often used a priest or a prophet to give an evaluation. Sometimes it was a lay person. I mean, heck, sometimes God didn't even use people at all. He used a worm and a big fish to give Jonah his evaluation and teach him a lesson. He used a talking donkey to teach Balaam a lesson and to give him his evaluation. And he used a rooster to give Peter his evaluation. The rooster was the proof. It was the culmination of what Jesus had said. The totality of all that Jesus had said. When Peter said, if everyone denies you, I won't. I never will. Jesus said, before the rooster crows in the morning, you will three times deny that you even know me. And I'm sure in that moment, Peter wouldn't accept that. He said, I don't believe that for a minute. But God used that rooster in the morning to bring all of Jesus' words back into Peter's mind and in his heart to give Peter his evaluation. You failed in this moment, Peter. It taught Peter one of the most valuable lessons of his entire life. Other times in Scripture, God would use heavenly beings like angels to give people their evaluation. And remember in Ezekiel 8, I preached about it a few years ago, when God took Ezekiel the prophet on a supernatural journey through a hole in the wall of the temple to reveal to him all of the detestable things that the priests were doing in hidden chambers inside the temple. And then over in 2 Samuel 12, when God had Nathan the prophet deliver to the king, the most powerful man in the nation, King David, to deliver David's evaluation and to reveal to David what all of the things that David was doing, all the sins in his life and his lifestyle and the things that he was doing that was putting a barrier up between him and God, the things that was keeping him separated from God. Sin separates us from God. There's no other way around it. Yes, he's a loving God. Yes, he loves us individually. But sin separates us from God. You cannot have it both ways. You can come to church every day of the week. And if you go out and you live in sin one day of the week, you are separated from God and in danger. Because anybody who's ever done that, walked away and been separated from the Lord, knows that the longer that behavior goes on, the easier it gets to ignore God and the more chance the world has to influence your heart and your mind and reprogram you. This is what David was going through. This is what all of these people I just named, Jonah, Peter, this is what all of them were doing. God was taking a moment in time to give them an evaluation, to say, think about this thing. Think about what you're about to do. So God will use people in our lives. He'll use a brother or a sister to give us an evaluation. He'll use his own words through Scripture if he can get us to open our Bibles and actually read and pray that God gives us a word just for us. He will give us evaluations every day of our lives, not to be critical of us, but to keep us on the right path, to help keep us from that trickle-down authority to the parent, to the child, God, to this generation, to the next generation. It's the same trickle-down effect to keep us from casting forward into the next generation a distorted view of the mercy of God. If our kids seeing us live, they see us sin and do things, and then we tell them not to do it, or they start reading the Bible, and the Holy Spirit, when they get in their teens or whatever, or become young adults, and they read in the Bible, and the Holy Spirit reveals to them, these things aren't right. And they're going to say, but my mom or my dad who raised me, who took me to church every day, engaged in these things. See, most of the time, when we react that way, when we ignore God's evaluations in our heart, most of the time, our kids and the people that we have influence over in our lives won't say a word. They'll just tuck it away. I don't know how many times that Satan brought back to my memory adult Christians in my life, people in the church, people I knew who had failed in front of me. And that was my excuse to stay out. Ironically, when I was away from God, that is when a lot of the TV preachers in the 80s had fallen, and I took glee. I was gleeful that they fell. That's how far away from God I was back then. See, I didn't see it as a tragedy. I saw it as, well, they finally got caught. This is what happens when we ignore the evaluations of the Holy Spirit in our heart. We cast forward to the next generation that these things are okay. It's okay to be lukewarm. And over time, it's like a copy of a copy of a copy. Pretty soon, it's such a faded view of Christianity that nobody really knows what the truth is. I believe that's the condition of the church today. And I believe that the Bible proves it. And you're going to see it in just a few minutes. In our first scripture, we're going to be in the book of Nehemiah, if you could make your way there. God has Nehemiah, who was a layman. He was not a priest. He had Nehemiah deliver an evaluation of the condition of his people. Nehemiah, again, he was not a priest like Ezra was. He was not a prophet like Malachi. But Nehemiah was a godly man. And sometimes God will look for a godly man or a godly woman to do something, to help bring evaluation into somebody's life. God will use every one of us to go to a brother or a sister. How many times have you walked up to somebody in the church family or a brother or sister you know out there in the world, somebody goes to another church or whatever, and you said, you know, you've been on my heart. I just wanted to call and pray with you. And they burst into tears and they say, God sent you. See, a lot of the times when God sends us to help offer his evaluation to another person, they're already waiting for it. And just the fact that we reach out to them is confirmation in their heart that God is at work. So Nehemiah was a godly man. Nehemiah served God, continued to serve God at a time when most of God's people had turned their backs on him. Once again, they turned their back on God, and God pulled his covering from them and left them to their own devices. And it wasn't long before they ended up in captivity, and the city of Jerusalem was in ruins, and God's people were taken as slaves. This is what happened at the time of Nehemiah, at the time of this scripture, this first scripture that we're going to read. God's people were divided. Nehemiah came from Judah. God's nation was divided, Judah and Israel, two separate factions. Israel was a mess. The temple was in total disarray. The walls that once protected the city were heaps of rubble. The big gates that they had were burned to ash. God's people had been captured, taken as slaves, and the remnant of Jews that were left behind in Israel, because God always leaves a remnant to carry on. And those people, because the generation before them had started pulling away from God, they didn't know how important God was to their survival. Read the story. It's very interesting. Nehemiah, years later, he heard that Jerusalem was in bad shape, so he asked God to make a way for him to go and see. And the book of Nehemiah is the account, it's the evaluation of what he saw when he got there. It was the evaluation of God's people. When he asked for permission, God made a way, because God had an evaluation that he wanted to be written, and he knew that Nehemiah was the man to do it. And today, all these thousands of years later, here we are. We have the book of Nehemiah. We have the evaluation of God's people. We can see what happens to God's people when they get away from God. His heart was so grieved at what he saw when he got there that he began to make, he allowed God to change his heart. He was so spiritually grieved in his heart for God's people that he decided that he's gonna ask God, what do you want me to do about it? And when the Lord told him, I want you to leave your family, to leave your home, to leave Judah, and come out here full time to try to get this thing back in shape, Nehemiah was so grieved that that was what he wanted to do. He was willing to leave everything he had so he can go back to Jerusalem. Besides the terrible physical condition of the city, there were three things in his evaluation about God's people that grieved him more than anything. And the reason I think God put this on my heart to bring today is because when we look at the church, I'm not talking about churches, denominations, or what for, though this message may fit for that. But the church on the whole, God's people, Christians, the body of Christ, I believe that this speaks exactly what we're going through today, spiritually speaking, exactly. Nehemiah 13, let's read verses 4 and 5. Nehemiah's motives were to try to bring the city and God's people back to him, back to God. Nehemiah 13, 4 and 5 says this, "Before this happened, Eliashib, the priest who'd been appointed as supervisor of the storerooms of the temple of our God and who was also a relative of Tobiah, had converted a large storage room and placed it at Tobiah's disposal." A large storage room in the temple. The room had previously been used for storing the grain offerings, the frankincense, various articles for the Levites, the singers, and the gatekeepers, as well as the offerings for priests. Now go up to verse 7. "When I arrived back in Jerusalem, I learned about Eliashib's evil deed in providing Tobiah with a room in the courtyards of the temple of God. I became very upset and threw all of Tobiah's belongings out of the room. Then I demanded that the rooms be purified, and I brought back the articles for God's temple, the grain offerings and the frankincense." See, the first thing in Nehemiah's evaluation was that church leaders, now listen to this, that church leaders had removed from the storehouse in the temple the true offerings made to God. They allowed, the church leaders allowed ungodly people to erase and replace God's things with their things. Even offerings and things that were offered up to false gods. So Nehemiah gets to the temple. It'd be like walking into the church and finding a statue of Angel Moroni on one side and Buddha over here. We would go, "What in the world?" This is what Nehemiah found. He found the city in ruins and the temple in total disarray. And it grieved his heart. It didn't just make him mad, it grieved his heart. From the grief of our heart comes spiritual anger. He was shocked by the temple leaders choosing to be inclusive with sinful society while compromising the reverence of God's house. Man, the reverence and the holiness of the temple was compromised. They had allowed leaders from false gods and false religions to come in among them and to join their things with God's things. See, God has always required separation from Christians. One of the big things that's happening in the church today is that everybody's okay. God's grace is so amazing, you can live however you want, and everybody's going to heaven. They've taken the standard, they've taken the instruction, and they've stopped teaching it and preaching it to the next generation. Everyone's okay. That's one of the things that's happening, I believe, in the church today. But God has always required that Christians be separate from the world. We can't just go out into the world and blend in. The world has to see us as peculiar people. Paul said, I count it a joy to do the foolishness of preaching the gospel. It makes no sense to the world what you and I are doing and how we're living and how we pray to a God that they say we can't see. The world thinks that you and I are crazy. But God has always required that Christians be separate from the world. So Nehemiah knew this, and he understood this when he saw the temple storehouses filled with things, God's stuff taken out, and this false religion stuff brought into the temple. He was shocked that they took God's things out, and he was filled with righteous anger, and he went in, and he threw out all the ungodly things from the temple storehouse. Does that sound familiar? That was a display of righteous anger in the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, the display of righteous anger was from Jesus himself. When he went in and he saw the money changers and the marketers buying and selling goods in the temple courtyards, and he was incensed. He was so incensed, and it wasn't just like he lost his temper. A lot of people say, well, Jesus lost his temper. No, he didn't. It was very calculated because he took time to take a cord and fashion a whip. It was righteous anger. And he said, my Father's house is a house of prayer, but you have turned it into a den of thieves. Thieves. What were they stealing? I'll tell you why Jesus is righteous anger. For the same reason Nehemiah had righteous anger. What they were stealing in Jesus' time is God requires first fruits from his people. They raise the lamb. They raise the dove. They find the spotless. They bring the first fruits of the crops or whatever into the storehouse of the Lord. But the religionists at that time, at Jesus' time, the well-oiled machine of Judaism, said, we'll make it easy for you. Just come to the temple and you can buy your sacrifices here. So they were buying animals wholesale, selling them at a profit, a guilt profit, a blood profit to the people who would buy it and take it in as if it was a sacrifice. Jesus understood that the money changers and the marketers took and they made believe, they made easy believism. That came out, that term came out in the 70s. They took something that was supposed to come from us individually, from the human, individually, God's people. A personal sacrifice. You cannot call it sacrifice unless it costs you something. And they had removed that option. It's like taking the heart out of something. And Jesus knew that that one thing alone was going to destroy the next generation, because the next generation would never give of themselves. They'll just go to church and write a check. And they'll think, I'm okay, because I give an offering. I go to the church, I get entertained for an hour, and I write them a check. But that's not what Christianity is. It's not what we are. God wants our first fruits. He wants our whole hearts. He doesn't need our money. He requires it not because he needs the money. He requires it because he wants us to be obedient to Scripture. That's why I don't know who tithes and who doesn't. I hope everybody does. I never preach on it because that's between you and God. It's a standard in the Bible. It's the only thing that God says, test me on this. And I can't needle somebody into doing it, or I've taken the heart out of it. But if you read the Bible, you'll see that it's a requirement of God. The first fruits. This is why Jesus' righteous anger was displayed in the temple that day. This is part of why Nehemiah's righteous anger, when he saw that the church leaders had allowed the world to come in and bring their stuff into God's house. He was incensed. You and I as believers should feel the same, that same kind of righteous anger, that calculated righteous anger. We should feel that every time that we see the church today inviting the world to come in and be among them and bring their stuff into God's house. The church has gotten so worldly in the 21st century that it's almost unrecognizable just in my lifetime. How many here over 60 can say they've seen a big change in the church? We should be incensed with righteous anger. In this text, it's no coincidence that the church leaders at the time when Nehemiah went, the time of this text, what did they remove from the storehouse? The things for the Levites and the singers. That's no coincidence. God wants us to see that. It's a key. Because a lot of church leaders today have taken out the true anointed worship music that's been a part of the church for generations because it's anointed. It has nothing to do with the style of music or the cadence of music or whether instruments play or don't play or whether a choir sings or don't play. I'm talking about the message in the music. They have removed the anointed music of the church and replaced worship with worship teams have replaced for a more polished entertainment style worship service. Music programs that look so much like the world, you can't tell the difference. I know I've said this before. I'm not harping on it. I'm saying we're seeing today exactly what Nehemiah saw. We're seeing the world come into the church and bring their talents, abilities, their polished programs into God's house, and we're seeing it allowed by church leaders today. And I'm not saying that new worship music's bad. I love it. There's a lot of anointed worship songs today. It has nothing to do with that. Again, it's not the style of music. What I'm talking about, listen carefully, I'm talking about the responsibility that church leaders have to recognize and remove from God's house anything that's of the world, that praises man more than it praises God. We have that responsibility. We need to remove the spirit of the world from God's house. So the first thing that bothered Nehemiah is that church leaders allowed the world to come in and bring their stuff with them, and they removed God's stuff out of his own house. The second thing is in verse 23. About the same time, I realized that some of the men of Judah had married women from Ashdod, Ammon, and Moab. Those of you that know your word know that it was you were not supposed to marry outside of the bloodline. You were not. There were certain cultures and societies that was forbidden for God's people to marry into. If they did, they would be unequally yoked. I believe the church today is in danger of marrying into the spirit of the age, of this age. We have joined ourselves with the spirit of this age. I say this all the time. Every three sermons I mention this because God will not let me let it go. When we choose to trade biblical instruction for political correctness, then we have married in to the spirit of the age. When we remove true worship from church for a more entertain-based policy or a polished entertainment-based show rather than a service that lives and breathes, then we've married into the spirit of the age. When preachers stop preaching from God's word and choose to stick to pop psychology, self-help, and secular humanism, then we've married in to the spirit of this age. God said, my people perish from a lack of knowledge. Think about it. This is what I'm talking about, the trickle-down effect. This is what this is all about. If you and I, if the preachers stop preaching it, and the teachers stop teaching it in the church, and then if you and I as believers don't go home and recognize, hey, our church leaders are missing the boat here, and if we in turn don't pass it along to our children, then we are right now, we are raising up and releasing a generation of children into the world who cannot tell the difference between what is holy and what is unholy, between what is worthy and what is unworthy. We have a responsibility. We'll release a generation in the world who has no idea, here we go, of what God expects from believers. Because there is an expectation. So that was the second thing that Nehemiah noticed. They'd married into other cultures. They started adapting the ideas, the false gods, the ways, everything else of the other cultures. They went against what God told them to do, and they compromised because of the lust of the flesh. They joined themselves with ungodly people. The third thing in Nehemiah's evaluation that grieved his heart is in verse 24. Furthermore, half of their children spoke the language of Ashdod, which is a false god, or of some other people, and could not speak the language of Judah at all. This one really bothered Nehemiah. And as you read this story, this one is what really incensed him, which bothered him the most. Because he realized that the language of their forefathers, the language of God's people, was absent. It was gone from the younger generation. They were completely fluent in the language of false gods, but they only knew a few Hebrew words and phrases. They were ignorant of the language of their heritage because the remnant of people that were left behind chose to marry into the spirit of the age, to that culture, false cultures, even though they knew that it wasn't right. So Nehemiah looked at these kids and he said, these kids, their parents have allowed them to not only adapt the language of a false god, they didn't teach them the language of their heritage. They were fluent in the language of the false god, but they knew nothing of the language of their heritage. They could tell you every pop star on the planet, but they couldn't name 12 disciples. They knew every movie that was out and when the release dates of albums were coming, but they couldn't tell you what time the church service started. Is it their fault? No. It's because this generation, the one before the generation of children today, have allowed it to happen. And this is what incensed Nehemiah. He knew that it was the parents' fault. Those false god languages was their primary language, and they didn't speak the language of their forefathers. He said, the language of our forefathers is gone from this generation, and it's happening again today. Because there's young people in the church today who do not know the language of the Spirit. What does that mean? They don't know the language of our forefathers. There's children today who go into church service, these polished, entertainment-oriented church services, and they've never seen altars. What is that bench up there in front? Is that for when we get tired? We can go sit on it? What's an altar in the church, Mommy? Because they don't have them anymore. There's a generation of Christians out there right now who are leaders in other churches who came from a generation who knew not God nor what He had done in Israel. And they took the altars out of the church. If they knew the purpose of those altars, they would have never removed the altars to make more room for more musicians. They would never have removed and taken out the windows and the light and paint everything black and get a fog machine. They would never have tried to substitute the Holy Spirit of God if they truly knew the Holy Spirit of God. I was asking a young person maybe a year ago or so that had come in once or twice. And I met with him after church and prayed with him, and he was telling me how he's raised up in the church. And he was dealing with addiction and a couple of other things. And I said, have you ever prayed through? He goes, prayed what? Have you ever prayed through? He didn't even know what that means. There's a generation in the church today that don't know what it means to pray through, because you never hear the words pray through anymore. Pray through is when you stay in prayer until you get a breakthrough. You stay on your knees and keep petitioning the Lord until you get victory and there's a breakthrough. They don't hear that anymore. They don't understand why people, when I say I'd like you to come and pray at the end, they sit there like, who's he talking about? Pray for what? What am I talking? What are they for? The generation of the church today doesn't speak the language of the Spirit. They don't understand how to bask in the presence of the Holy Spirit, to where the clock on the wall disappears, where they can put their phone in their pocket or in their purse and leave it there and off and let the Holy Spirit of God move. They're not looking, I got to get out of here, and my friend's texting me right now what they're having for lunch, and I got to go join them, so come on, hurry up, preacher. We need to get out of here. When you walk and you bask in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the first thing to disappear is time, and you just want to be with God. The language of our heritage, of our forefathers, is gone from this generation of the church. That should grieve our hearts just as it grieved Nehemiah's heart. There's more to language than just words. You know what I mean by that? There's more to a language than just words. Embedded in languages are social mores. For example, I could say to you, Juliet on her balcony. And most of you who've had American Lit 1 would understand, you would get a visual. You would understand that that's more than four words. Juliet on her balcony. It paints a picture because you know the story. You've been introduced to the characters. It means more to you than just the four words that it's wrapped up in. This is what the language of God should do in the heart of a believer. When you say, come to an altar, we're going to pray through, they should say, oh, hallelujah. Thank God I've been looking for a church like this that will still have an altar call at the end of the service and still be willing to thee. They may not even know me, but they're going to come and they're going to gather around me and they're going to pray for me. It's gone. Today's generation of the church says all that old stuff, even the altars, all of that old stuff is not necessary. Any older person that wants to stand up and talk about the power of the Holy Spirit, they'll say, maybe do that in your go get in a group. Go get in a focus, or what do they call those, a home group. Go find a home group of other people of your ilk, and maybe you guys can go speak in tongues over there, but let's keep this kind of neutral, because a lot of people find the Holy Spirit talk off-putting. They're finding the language, the Spirit language, the prayer language off-putting, because they know not God nor what He's done for His people. I'm not crazy. This is truth. It's happening before our very eyes. It's not necessary anymore. The reason they think that is because they've adopted the language of false gods and false prophets. And they've become fluent in the language of entertainment. But they cannot speak a word of the Spirit, the language of their forefathers. We've adopted the language of our culture and left the language of the Spirit behind. But the culture today, again, doesn't teach the language of sacrifice. You look at a young kid today, and when I was a kid growing up in the church, When you got close to 18 years old, men of God would approach you and say, have you considered maybe going to Bible college? Have you considered maybe going for a year and doing a ministry or going on a mission trip? It was commonplace. You expected it. But now you go to a church leader and say, hey, I want to ask the kids if they want to go on a mission trip. A mission trip? What are you talking about? Because the language of our forefathers, the language of sacrifice, is not being taught in this generation. Sacrificing of yourself for the house of God is not being taught because everything is bought and paid for. Come as you are. Come as you want to be. You do nothing. You don't have to volunteer for nothing. You don't have to do anything. Just come in and be a part of the hour and a half service and jump around and sing your worship songs and then go home and be spiritually empty for the rest of the week. This sounds critical, but it's truth. The three things that Nehemiah saw that grieved his heart are the exact same three things that grieves the heart of God today and should grieve the heart of every believer. Can I get an amen? People don't even consider giving of themselves, sacrificing of themselves, and it's because we've married into the culture more than we've married ourselves to God. When we begin to speak less and less the language of God, the language of faith, the language of true worship, the language of Jesus and the blood, the language of saying, I want to plead the blood of Jesus over you. They don't know what it means today. When we speak less and less of the language of God and more the language of the culture in the church, which is everybody's okay, just come on in, people got enough problems. I want to tell you, God loves you. That's true, but doggone it, there's standards. You are sending a generation of people into the world who don't know the social and spiritual mores that God, through His Holy Spirit, wants to do in the heart and the life of every single believer. We don't understand the power that we have. It's because we started speaking more of the language of the culture and less the language of the Spirit. But you know what? God's command for believers to be separated in Christ, to be convicted of your sin, to recognize your sin and repent of your sin, even if it hurts, still stands for every believer. And we're going to be held accountable for what we do and what we don't do when it comes to honoring God, when it comes to pouring His word and His language into our kids and our young people, because we are responsible for the next generation of the church. It has to start with the remnant. Nehemiah knew this. That's why he was willing to give his whole life and move back to Jerusalem to do everything in his power to get the city and God's people back to God. That should be our call. Just like when Joshua entered into the promised land, you know, he and Caleb were the only two to get to go in of all the people that wandered in the desert. It wasn't until that whole generation had lain down and died that God allowed the two that were faithful, the two spies that said, let's go, we could take this land 40 years earlier. But Moses was afraid. The people were afraid. They didn't go in. They didn't take God's gift. So he let them wander for another 40 years until that entire generation had lain down and died. And Joshua and Caleb go in, and you know what? When Joshua, they're in the promised land, they're starting to rebuild stuff, they're fighting and winning battles, and Joshua goes around and he starts talking to the young people. And he realizes that the young people didn't know anything about what God had done in Israel. They knew nothing about the Exodus. They knew nothing about how the angel of death passed over them They knew nothing about how God led them through the desert with a pillar of fire and a cloud in the daytime, how he provided manna from the air. They knew nothing about what God had done. And Joshua even said that. He said there came a generation, those that were born after the Exodus, there arose a generation after them that knew not the Lord nor the works he'd done in Israel. Because when there's an abandonment of teaching the Word of God and being disciple builders in our homes first, and then in our church, remember the trickle down. If the church is failing to preach and teach the truth, the Bible, all of it, and your kids want to know why the teachers at school are saying that you can pick any, be any sex you want to be, and that it's okay, and that parent should be able to stand up immediately and counteract that with Scripture and say, that's a lie. Here's what God says about it. Starts in the home. When it's done in the home, it'll once again be done in the church. When we talk less and less about the Word of God and more about the culture, we're failing our children. We're failing our grandchildren. We're failing our great-grandchildren. We need to counteract everything, all this junk that they're getting from this messed up society that they're trying to integrate and sneak it into the church a little at a time. You'd be surprised at what some of these little children say to Linda and some of the other teachers. A little kid was with them the other day. 2 weeks ago, they came. A family came. How you doing? Oh, fine. We're looking for a church. Are you guys Christians? Oh, yeah. We're fourth generation Christians. We've raised our kids and homeschooled our kids in the church, raised them in the church and all this stuff. And in the Bible study, Linda asked one of the kids, have you ever been saved? And he says, what is that? I've never heard that. It has to start in the home. If the church is dropping the ball, to get this thing back on the right track, this remnant has to start in our homes. That's why I'm so blessed with Sister Emily's call from God, answering the call to minister to her family and Sister Tedra and others that are stepping in and being the ministers, speaking the truth to their families. We need to show them how to be faithful by being faithful ourselves. We need to show them how to worship in this church. That's why we have children in our worship services. From day one, when we talked about this church, we didn't want a church that separates the children at worship, because our four-year-olds need to walk around and see how happy you all are to greet one another. They need to see us with hands raised, with tears streaming down our face, so they'll ask the question, Mommy, why is he crying? He's crying because he's filled with the joy of the Holy Spirit. Those are tears of joy. And this is what they mean. Our children need to hear this, because they're not. We need to communicate to them, so that way they'll communicate it in the future. So the three things that Nehemiah's evaluation that bothered him the most was, one, they let the world bring ungodly things into the temple. Two, they married themselves into ungodly cultures and false gods and beliefs. And three, they didn't teach or pass down to their children the language of their heritage. You can clearly see that this Word of God from the Old Testament is alive and well in the 21st century, because this is a word for you and I as believers. Because God gave us an evaluation. Jesus looked forward in time because he's already been in our future. Chew on that over lunch. He's already been in our future. And Jesus, while he walked this earth, constantly told us what to watch for in the future. In the last days, there will be ABC. That was a message from him to us. And in the book of Revelation, he gave John an evaluation of the church of the future, us And again, the evaluations were to say, here's your weaknesses, here's your strengths. Here's what I like about you, here's what I don't like about you. And Jesus gives the evaluation to you and I, the church in the 21st century. This is our evaluation. He told them things he liked and what he didn't, and he gave them a remedy to change themselves or end up facing the consequences. I'm going to read these. The church at Smyrna is the first of two churches that Jesus commended but didn't admonish. The first was the church at Smyrna. The second was the church at Philadelphia. He didn't admonish them. He said that they had an open door, even though they only had a little strength. Compared to their environment around them, they only had a little strength, but they had an open door. They feared not before the Lord. They kept the word of God. They had not denied God. So those two are great progress reports, but here we go. The church at Ephesus. God commended them for their good works and discipline, for guarding against false teachings, but he admonished them, here we go, for losing their first love. In other words, as a church, on the outside, they looked good. They were doing good deeds. They were in the community. But in their hearts, they had lost their first love. They had lost the heart. Their heart wasn't in what they were doing. The next one was the church at Pergamos. Jesus said it showed strength existing in that horrible place. But he admonished them because they allowed idolatry into the church. They yoked paganism with the gospel. The next was the church at Thyatira. On the surface, they were a loving and faithful church. But Jesus admonished them for allowing the immorality of one woman, one person, to corrupt the whole church. The church at Sardis, Jesus had absolutely nothing good to say about the church at Sardis. Only criticism. And here's why. He said, because the ministry of the Holy Spirit, listen close, the church at Sardis, he had nothing good to say because the ministry of the Holy Spirit was shut out from among them. They were having church, but they were rejecting the power and ministry of the Holy Spirit. We see a lot of that today. The church at Laodicea is famous for being the one that Jesus said would be lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, and that God would spew it from his mouth. It's also famous. It got the harshest evaluation from Jesus. Jesus actually said the church made him ill. It made him sick. It was lacking in every way. It was compromising. It was conceited. And it was Christless. You and I are the church. It starts in here, within our hearts. The Holy Spirit will give you a progress report every single day. He'll give you an evaluation. It's called conviction. Sometimes you'll feel that you don't know why you feel this, but you just know that you're on the right track. That's God confirming himself. That's his evaluation, confirming his work in you. So every day you and I get evaluations from God. Every day you and I need to seek those evaluations and say, okay, God, what can I do? What can I do, Lord, to be more in line with what you want of me? Because when we get it right as individuals, it'll spread into the church. it'll spread into the next generation. But we're fastly approaching the end times, and the church is fastly approaching the Laodicean church of the end times. You and I, as the remnant, we need to do everything we can to stop this from happening. Like Brother James always says, he goes, I've read the book, I know how it ends. God wins. And he's right. I don't worry about it either way. God wins. But you know what? I don't want to see my grandchildren and my children suffer in eternal darkness because they didn't know something that was my job to tell them. As a pastor, I don't ever want to stand up here and deliver some fluffy message that makes everybody happy because it would be easier for me. I want to be on my knees every week and saying, what do you have, God? What do you want me to say? Good, bad, or ugly? I'm yours as long as you got me here. All of us have this responsibility. And what a joy it is. We get to spread the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We get to pray with one another and help pull each other out of the ditches and elevate one another. It's awesome to be a Christian. We need to look at it like that. Amen? Let's stand. Thank you for joining us today. I hope the Holy Spirit spoke deeply into your heart through today's message. You know, we have this incredible opportunity at this point in time. We've got this technology at our fingertips that the disciples and the apostles could only dream of. So if the message spoke to you today, then forward that message, share it with a friend or a family member, because chances are they could use it too. That's the beauty. If you don't think there's anything that you could do for the Lord, if you don't feel you have a talent for any sort of ministry, there's two things you could do. You can always be a prayer warrior, and you can share the gospel of Jesus Christ simply by forwarding these messages to a friend or a family member. If you'd like to help support Servant's Heart Worship Center, we would truly appreciate it, and we want you to know that we will always be good stewards with everything that God supplies this church. Your tithes are for your local church, so don't tithe to this church unless you're a part of this church family. But if you'd like to make an offering, a donation, I guarantee you it's going to go to a good cause to help support this ministry and to further the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the nation and the other parts of the world. So if you'd like to donate, just click the donate button or go to our website at servantsheartworshipcenter.com and follow the instructions from there. Thank you, and God bless you.